Hello, I'm Thomas Mace-Archer-Mills, Chairman of the British Monarchist Society and Foundation. Thank you kindly for inviting me to be with you today and address you from one organisation supporting the Queen to another. The British Monarchist Society came about as a thought. Then it turned into action. Then it turned into a viable organisation which enjoys support from royal warrant holders, from corporations, from individuals. Richard Stone, the court painter of Her Majesty the Queen and the Royal Family. Patti Boulay, royal entertainer and a designer of the Golden Jubilee celebrations for Her Majesty. Christian Corbett, a Canadian, court sculptor to Her Majesty the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh. We have so many patrons that are not just attached to the Royal Family, but employed by the Royal Family. Over 100 MPs of Her Majesty's government and several lords, peers, life peers, that understand Her Majesty, that understand constitutional monarchy. We here in the United Kingdom are very lucky to enjoy such support. But you in Australia, you have support of the people. You have become vigilant. You have learned from what happened in 1999. And that is an example that needs to be brought around the world. That is an example that your chairman, Mr. Philip Benwell, brought to us loud and clear last July when he spoke in the House of Lords. And he warned us. Everyone there, they understood. They saw the example. Complacency could be the death of our crown. Vigilance, however, is the other side of the coin. Vigilance through education, vigilance through care, vigilance through compassion. We need to understand our foe. We need to respect them. Republicans are everywhere, and here in the United Kingdom, the Republic organization is rife with not only politicians, but the people. The people who don't understand, who don't value their monarchy, who don't value their tradition, who blatantly disrespect Her Majesty, who is the personification of our state, who is the living embodiment of 1,000 years of not just our history, but also yours. Together, as a united front with the Australian Monarchist League, we can truly make a difference. We can create an example to the rest of the realms and their monarchist organizations to show that there is no harm in working together. We work well with each other. The British Monarchist Society and the Australian Monarchist League, we're not just friends, but we're companions. We believe in the fundamental basis of our constitutional monarchy. We believe in the respect of Her Majesty and our royal family. And together, what we can do will be a solid example of what we can invite the other monarchist organizations around Her Majesty's realms to join in with. Here in the United Kingdom, the British Monarchist Society has created the Red Box Programme. We've fashioned that after the red boxes that go to and from Her Majesty every day with the papers of state that she must sign. Those boxes carry important papers that deal not just with Her Majesty's subjects here in the Kingdom, but they deal with so many other issues that affect you in the realms. They affect those in Canada, Australia, New Zealand, down to the Caribbean, Belize, all across this wonderful world that we inhabit together. In working together through education, in working together through conferences, in working together through getting the word out to the people of Her Majesty's realms about the sheer importance of education and the sheer importance of not becoming complacent, that will be our lasting legacy for the world. I want to thank you first and foremost for allowing me to address you, to be part of this vigilance-themed conference in Australia. It is not often that we are met with such welcoming and open arms for other monarchist organizations. But you, the AML, through your chairman, through your administration, you've been wonderful. You understand what we're up against here in the United Kingdom. You understand what other realms are up against. What the British Monarchist Society has invited the Australian Monarchist League to do is next year, in the Q90 as we term it, the 90th birthday of Her Majesty the Queen, we want to have a joint conference here in London to which we would like to invite you, all of you, to come to partake in this joint conference which will be styled and fitted around Monarchy. Monarchy fit for purpose, a tribute to Her Majesty and the 64 years of service she has given, undoubtedly, to her people. Through education, through the conference, through working together, we can be a model of absolute cohesiveness in favour of Her Majesty and the constitutional monarchies under which we all live. So, on behalf of the British Monarchist Society and British monarchists throughout the kingdom, thank you. We are very much honoured and humbled and excited to be in Australia with you. Vigilance is the absolute key and a necessity to the continuation of what we feel is so important. And that here, in not just England, but also Australia and throughout Her Majesty's realms, is of course the Crown. So I address you today not as the chairman of the British Monarchist Society and Foundation, but a friend, a fellow defender of the Crown, to unite in one general force, which is to protect Her Majesty, her heirs and successors, and of course, the most important establishment that we all love and cherish, the Crown. We might be in an age where Republicans are taking over and we see them growing left and right. Whereas what happened in Australia at the referendum in 1999, you came very, very close to losing your crown. When I think of Australia, I don't think of a British queen down there flying the flag strictly for Britain and what it means to the rest of the world. Those days have come and gone. With the end of empire came the Commonwealth, of which, of course, you know, the Queen is the head. But Australia, in its own right, with its own crown and constitution, the Queen and her family are very much an Australian Queen and an Australian royal family. The notion of Australia being a crowned republic is absolute nonsense in the minds of us here who don't live in Australia. How can you have a crowned republic? It simply does not make sense. It does not live in harmony. So when your chairman, Mr. Philip Benwell, paid us a visit last year, we warmly welcomed him, and it was great to see a good friend and an advocate of constitutional monarchy. Philip shared with us so many good things, but he most importantly brought with him a message. He brought with him a warning to us here: never ever be complacent with the crown. And that is what we have done here in England. 7 years ago, I had an idea. 5 years ago, I acted on that. And 3 years ago, I officially made the British Monarchist Society an absolute company, which was dedicated, of course, to crown and country. I identified the points within the United Kingdom that went ahead and led me to believe that complacency was rife, that if things were not absolutely identified, we would be in danger. Our government over the successive years have stripped royal history out of the programme. They have gone ahead and removed the important facets and facilities which have been guarded by our monarchs for centuries. If we are unable to continue educating the young about the importance of the crown in a modern day constitutional monarchy, which is the fundamental basis of the parliamentary democracy which we enjoy and we love, what are we to do? We might find ourselves here in the United Kingdom very much like you in Australia, with a referendum on our crown, our Queen and our royal family. This is something that we have indicated must not happen. And therefore, it's up to us, the Brotherhood of the Commonwealth Monarchist Organizations, to work together. Some of us say, well, the crown is not all of our crowns. It's strictly a Canadian crown, or it's strictly a New Zealand crown, or it's strictly a British crown. We have constitutions which make us our own country. But that constitution shares one establishment. We share one head of state. Though we might be British, we might be Australian, we are all the same subjects under Her Majesty the Queen. When King Edward VII came to the throne, he felt it important to acknowledge the empire. And in doing so, when he actually approved the plans for the Mall and the Victoria Memorial, which is right here in front of Buckingham Palace, it included several gates. Australia Gate to my right, and this, Canada Gate, directly to my left. For those of you that have been here to London, that have been to the Mall in front of the palace, you will see that these structures are not small. They are large representations of what the empire has meant, not only to the United Kingdom and to Britain, but to the people themselves. We have lived together, we have fought together, we have died together. And that sort of bond is not broken easily. It is so important that we as monarchists and organizations around the realms that support monarchy work together. We can learn from each other, such as we here in Britain have done from the example that the Australian Monarchist League have presented to us. There is so much we can do to strengthen ties between all of the realms, all of the monarchist organizations that we belong to. Just recently, on the 18th of May, the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation put out a poll, and it was a poll that was a bit worrying to me. 4 out of 10 now in Canada agree with the abolition of the monarchy upon the death of the Queen. I do not understand and I do not agree. I've lived in a monarchy, I've lived in a republic. The grass is not always greener on the other side. The recent poll that was released by the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation provided some very interesting numbers. And we look at the demographics and see something that is changing. Young people are now looking at the monarchy, they're looking at the institution and saying, does it matter? And then you have another demographic, people who make a lot of money, 80 to 100,000 a year. They're looking at the purpose of the institution. But when we look at the stats and we look at the demographic, we see something that is always a plague. We're looking at a Republican ideology which is grabbing hold. We are looking at the eradication of education. We are looking at people not understanding the role of the monarch, the role of our monarchy, and the efficiency of our royal family. They are losing exactly the understanding of what sets the realms apart from the rest of the world. The royal family and the Queen herself are there to fight against an overzealous crowd of politicians who are power hungry, who seek the seat of ultimate power for themselves, who will do anything to obtain that. Years of election, billions of pounds, or billions of dollars in America spent to obtain the highest seat in the land, which can be bought, which can be obtained through corruption, through foul elections, through name calling, through horrible campaigns that don't unite a people but divide a people. The sovereign in the ultimate seat of power protects against that. It protects against an overzealous body of politicians whose number one practice is greed and power, not the people. When we look at these statistics that the CBC put out, 44% of men do agree that when Queen Elizabeth unfortunately dies, that they do not want to continue as a constitutional monarchy. 46% of people who make $80,000 to $100,000 a year in Canada, 71% of Quebecers, 72% of Francophones, 49% of NDPers, and a startling statistic, 46% of mothers with children under 18 favor abolishing the monarchy in Canada when the change of crown comes. And for those of you in Australia that have dealt with this, you have combated republicanism head on. You have seen what complacency has done. You have brought that message here to the United Kingdom. Your chairman has said to us, look, this is what can happen. This is what will happen. Vigilance is not only the key, it is the theme of your conference, and it is the theme that we here in the United Kingdom need to take seriously. We need to be more proactive here. We need to engage our young people. We need to look at the difference between Republicans and monarchists, and in doing so, we need to identify why their ideology is somewhat flawed. Have they lived in a republic? Which models are they using? Why would they not only want to put themselves in peril and erase their history by creating this a politician's playground? Why would you create this instead of the Queen's palace, a presidential palace? Would it mean the same? When we look at all of these people around, when we look at this palace, when we look at the changing of the guard happening, would it pull the people? Would it pull the ideology? Would it evoke true emotion? Or would it be just another stage set for politicians? Only you can answer that. Only I can answer that. but we together, as a united front, as defenders of the crown, can take that question and pose it not only to our individual countries, but to those fellow realms that might be in the same position that Australia was once in. The monarchists are on top again in Australia. And I've heard a lot of things. Oh, well, republicanism is dead, and now when the news media comes to us, it's always to a monarchist. Well, it's that sort of complacency that led Australia to the referendum that it was in the first place. And I take that as another warning, that just because Australia is back on top and monarchy seems to be prevailing, does not give anyone the right to say republicanism is dead. In fact, it might be in retreat, it might be hidden somewhere, but the point is, it is still there. And if complacency is allowed to take over, the vigilance is gone. And without vigilance, and without any sort of action, and allowing complacency to again rear its head, you're not letting Republicans retreat, you're letting them regain their force. You're letting them hide in cracks and crevices. You're letting them build momentum out of the open eye. And that is a warning which I can see. So as vigilance is the key theme of the conference that you are at right now, I want to return the favor that Philip brought to us. I want to return the warning signs that he brought to us. You have done a phenomenal job in Australia, and I commend you for that. There's so much that we can learn here in the United Kingdom from you. But number one, complacency is a danger. Two, vigilance. Vigilance is the key. Three, do not ever let them exist together. Republicanism is not dead. It is just finding another way to rear its head and battle again another day. There you are. Perfect fit. Sean, you are ready to go. You look magnificent in all your majesty and your regalness. Sean the Sheep, we have a little fun here in London. Monarchy is always so stiff and proper and firm, and how dare you make fun and have a laugh. But the royal family and the Queen herself, they have a wicked sense of humour, and so should we. If it's something that I can say to you in Australia, never mind the sun and the beautiful weather that we have here, which I'm sure you thought it would be raining, but today I want to say to you that sometimes monarchists can be their own worst enemy. They don't see the humour, they don't take the opportunity to have fun with it. So we can believe in the cause, we can take it seriously, but the point is, don't take it too seriously to the point where it's detrimental to the cause. That's what Republicans do. They take it so seriously that they do not enjoy. They do not have fun. A lot of times they come across as miserable people, killjoys. But we as monarchists, we understand, we get it. And in a city that lives and breathes monarchy, I can certainly say for myself, and I know that Sean the Sheep will agree with me, that it's about having fun. It's about celebrating. And you there at the conference, and I am so, so happy and thankful that you have allowed me to speak with you today. I want to tell you that together, the work that we do, together, the message we can send, and together, the relationships we can create will matter. They will matter for Crown, they will matter for country. But when we are long gone, it will still matter to those people that we have provided an education for, that we have provided examples for. And you in Australia, you have fought for it, you have given for it, and you have saved your crown for future generations. I hope that we don't come to that here in England, where we have to fight tooth and nail to retain the very things that make us as British people British, which made you as Australians Australian. Thank you for allowing me to be with you today. God save the Queen.